werewolves, ghosts, and Bigfoot. Oh my. It's just another night for Supernatural Girlz. Real stories, real answers to life's biggest supernatural mysteries. And now for another exciting interview with paranormal experts from this world and others. Here's your host, paranormal researcher Patricia Baker, on the one, the only Supernatural Girlz.
Welcome, everyone, to another exciting episode of Supernatural Girlz Radio. I am your host, Patricia Baker, and I'm here with my co-host all the way from Tucson, Arizona, Patricia Kirkman. PK, how you doing tonight?
Just absolutely fabulous. I can't wait to speak with our guest tonight.
Oh, my God. Well, Patrice Chaplin's with us tonight. She is the top of the top, isn't she? I mean, an amazing, powerful, talented woman. They don't come any better than this, right?
I have to agree with you. And then some that I know there's more to add to it that we've missed.
Get there. Yes. I mean, we could just spend the whole evening just talking about how great she is, but we're going to let her speak for herself on these amazing experiences that she's had looking for and finding the Stone Cradle, which we are going to get to tonight. But first, we've got some really exciting things we've been working on, don't we?
Yes, we do. Very interesting.
Here's, for our audience, I think you're all going to be very excited to hear this, and we want your participation in what we're doing. Now, what we have done is we have taken some of the cases of missing people that have been identified publicly and in the writings of David Paulides in his Missing 411 series. If you haven't read the series, you should. It's an amazing account, and it's a factual account of people that have gone missing in the United States and also 9 other countries that he's identified under extremely mysterious circumstances. They all fit the same MO, pretty much. And today we identified a case that we wanted to work on with you, PK, with your numerology. And so we're going to start there. And then from there, we're going to move on to George Lugo and myself do something called a skull experiment, where we get together and we do it on Skype since we're in different states, and we are able to contact these people and other entities and try to figure out here what is going on. So we're going to tell you what PK is going to tell you what she found, and then I'm going to tell you what George Lugo and I found tonight. Now, George is, in our opinion, one of the top psychics in the world. He's worked with Scotland Yard. He has been doing readings and been a psychic medium almost all of his life. Tremendous talent, and he's the one working with us on this. So, PK, I'm going to just set the scene. This is who we are trying to find. His name is Brian Schaffer, and he disappeared April 1st, 2006 from Columbus, Ohio. He was 27 years old, a second year medical student, and he was no lightweight. He was 6'2", 165 pounds, so not somebody who could be easily overtaken. And he was seen by a CCTV camera going into a bar called the Ugly Tuna, but he was never seen leaving it. And he has never been seen again. And that was so many years ago, but we are putting some effort into taking a look at this case on other planes, on other levels, with energy, with numbers, etc. And we're going to try to find what happened to Brian. And if there's a way to bring him home, we're going to do it. So, PK, get us started with the numbers of Brian, his name, his birth date, and the day he went missing.
Okay. Well, firstly, he has a 9 achievement number. A 9 is the master of all numbers because it brings in everything together. 9 deals with the world at large, and it's what we do to entice others to go forward and look deeper into what's taking place. He has a chart that he's very, very bullheaded, very headstrong, but he's ultra sensitive. And he never has the idea of knowing who or what to trust. This is something that he's worked with all of his life. So the issues, I'm picking up something to do with a female because of his issues where the, and I'll use the word the mother figure, but it doesn't necessarily mean his mother per se. But there's that sensitive side of him that he, even through the name Brian, he's ultra sensitive, although he's extremely, extremely headstrong. Doesn't like change, but he has a hard time connecting with the spiritual side, which is strange because so much of who he is goes to that side. It's like it deals with the ultra sensitive, and yet he doesn't know how to step out of it or totally into it to give him the opportunity to, excel at these things that he's getting. Now, he doesn't like change. He would go overboard to eliminate change. But he wants to be in control, and yet he doesn't have faith in what he does, and he doesn't know how to express what he wants.
So what we're talking about, it sounds like, is a bit of, and we all have these contradictions mm-hmm. within our personalities, but somebody who is not in touch in a grounded way with their own spiritual connection, it sounds like.
That is extremely correct.
Now, he disappeared on a 5-day, right?
Right.
Tell us about that, because that's very interesting.
Okay. The 5 deals with change and the ability to accept changes and to dig into things that make things different. In his chart, he has a hard time working with change. He kind of like digs in his heels, does not allow it to take place. The very same way that the spiritual side of him, he ignores it and he kind of pushes it away. So the two areas that would give him, shall we say, extra power, if you want to call it that, because his inability to accept changes in what he believes in, his own faith, he doesn't trust. And yet he's supposed to be here on behalf of other people, and he keeps stepping into I keep getting the wrong light, if that makes any sense. Mm-hmm. It's like he's stepping into places he doesn't belong, yet he isn't doing anything to help himself. When he went missing, the element that was going on around him at that point in time dealt with the 5, again, which he doesn't like. It deals with change or changes. And that
and
makes
quick
very,
change also, right?
Oh, very
fast.
Very abrupt. Very abrupt.
Which is what this was.
Exactly. And it's like you'd be driving down the road, look down at your speedometer, find that you're going 100 miles an hour when you thought you were going 10.
Right.
It just, everything is out of balance. And that's what I keep picking up around him. His sensitive side puts him out of balance with who he wants to be. There's something here that just doesn't ring true to who he wanted to be and what he's doing. It's like a great escape. You can't make it happen. It has to happen in its own right. And whatever took place, he himself, the sensitive side of him, would have stepped in and accepted something at the wrong time because of his lack of belief or lack of faith.
Very interesting. So thank you so much for looking into this. And we're trying again to take a lot of different pieces from different paranormal places mm-hmm. because clearly following logic isn't finding this young man. And when George and I started this, we started looking into him, the first feeling both of us had is that he may still very well be alive. And that was unusual, first of all, but that's what we both felt. The other thing we both saw very clearly, that if he is alive, where he is in a warehouse type of structure. This is not the kind of structure that has an address on the outside. It's like as large as half of an airplane hangar. Very, very large structure. Now, what we saw was not pleasant also, as you know, PK, right?
Right.
So what we saw was a situation where there are other entities involved, And he is not allowed to go anywhere, do anything. He is there for their purpose and serving their purpose, whatever that is. Now, again, this is our first opportunity to take a look at where he might be and what he's doing. And we made contact with him. He saw us in his mind's eye. He knew we were trying to contact him. He made contact with us. And we told him we would like to see him come home. Now, again, there's something that George picked up on that's very interesting around the number three.
Mm-hmm.
And this, again, will turn back to you, PK. But what George saw is that there's a limitation here, that something's going to happen around a three, whether it's 3 days, 3 months, or 3 years. There's an end date on his usefulness, and he knows it, too. So it's giving him anxiety because he doesn't know exactly what's going to happen. But certainly in other cases, we've seen potentially what can happen. It's not good.
Well, in his chart, when we're taking a look at three, he has a difficulty expressing what he really wants to. But his ability to make change is garnered by the number three. So his number that gives him the opportunity to make changes, he's got locked in with the number three.
So he needs to really blast through that karmic three and be able to start expressing what he wants. And what we picked up on is, yes, he does want to come home, but again, he is limited severely by what he can do by these entities. Now, one of the things that we do during these skull sessions is we take photographs of the screen because strange things happen. And we are going to start posting those photographs on our Facebook page and on our website, supernaturalgirlz.com. Be sure to follow us. Be sure to give us a like and a follow so that you can see these things, because they are beyond belief. We got a chance to take a look at what one of these entities that's holding him may in fact look like. And the whole idea here is this. If there is a stronger and greater and more advanced technology involved, which clearly there must be, what gives these things the right to take human beings away from their families and their loved ones and do whatever they're doing? We want answers. We want to know what's going on here. And we also think, again, we've had guests on, PK, like David Weatherly,
mm-hmm.
that have said they feel strongly that there are compartmentalized places within the government and military that know what's going on, but they're not talking about it. So this, again, did not look like it was a human-to-human thing. And it looked, you'll see from the photo, it, and again, your opinion, PK, here is warranted. Didn't look human to me.
Well, you know what I'm concerned about or curious about when you speak with George on the next episode of this, because I keep seeing boxes, like compartmentalized, this large area that you're in, but I'm seeing boxes stacked inside that space. Now, whether they're a chamber for a person or there's other things ongoing, but it's almost like a box attached to a box attached to a box.
Yeah, actually, it's funny you should say that, because yes, he did see boxes in this space. He also saw that Brian's feet were almost like in the floor. Not mm-hmm. just on the floor, they were in the floor. And by the end of the session, we were just about to close up when we heard a male voice say, "Help." So we're staying with this, and we're going to report back to everybody about our progress. And we're asking for all of you to pray, to send your prayers to Brian Schaffer, that he's able to finally come home. It's about time, wouldn't you say? So any thoughts that you have in the audience, any suggestions, any theories you have on what is happening here with Brian and other people that are disappearing in an instant, literally right in front of us. We don't know where they're going, but now we're going to find out. So we'd love hearing from our audience about this and anything else. Feel free to contact us. Again, message us on Facebook. Go to our website, supernaturalgirlz.com. Follow us on Twitter, and feel free to communicate with us anytime. We love hearing from you. We love our audience, and we want to do our best for you. And also, the people like Brian Schaffer, never forget them. We're going to bring them back around, do what we can from our side of the fence in the paranormal world to help get them back, to help bring peace and healing to the people around them that have been left behind. So that's a project, everybody. We're happy to include you in it. So now, my God, that was a big, big piece of excitement here.
And even more to add to the excitement is having Patrice with us.
Oh, my goodness. Now, again, we could just go on and on talking about Patrice Chaplin because she's an amazing, talented, and she's just an initiate. My God, mm-hmm. She knows so many things. She's an author. She's a journalist. She's a playwright. But most importantly, she is tuned in to the spiritual connection, what is going on in the world today. And her journey began at 15 years old when she happened upon the Spanish city of Gerona in 1955. And she became increasingly involved with the Grail's historic origins, Gerona's private Kabbalist society, and the history and purpose behind Rennes-le-Château. Now, she's got great books out there. I could list them all, but it would take too long. Go to Amazon. You can buy all of her books there. And she has been on our show previously talking about mm-hmm. The Portal, a great book. But tonight, we're going to talk a little bit about The Portal because it's still a hot topic. But then we're going to move right on to this mysterious object, the Stone Cradle. And that's Patrice's new book. You got to get a copy. It's a terrific book, a great, great read. But tonight, we're so lucky and so blessed to have Patrice Chaplin on the air with us. Patrice, welcome to the show.
Hello, good evening.
What a pleasure for us.
Yeah, what a pleasure to have you here. My goodness. Oh, we have so much to talk about. Let's start with The Portal. What a terrific book that is. Now, people can still buy that on Amazon, right?
They can. Yes. They can buy it. Yeah, it's the one before it was called City of Secrets, and then mm-hmm. The Portal was the follow-up. And The Stone Cradle is, the resulting book. It's a final book.
Well, you have been on quite a journey, and as we were talking earlier, you are one courageous lady, because here you go from Rennes-le-Château on this big hike and trek all the way to Gerona, Spain, right to the edge of the portal. Now, what was that journey like for you? Was it physically challenging?
No. I think it wasn't. I didn't know at all what it would be like, and when I started, I had no idea what a portal was. So it was only when I worked with the guide, I had to be, and in fact, one should always work with a guide, someone who knows what a portal is and how to approach a portal and whether or not you're supposed to take the portal journey. That's very important. And if you go to a portal and you're sucked in, for example, into that passageway and into that other dimension, you know, there's a strong chance you may not get back. I think doing a portal journey is a vital thing because it changes everything about the way you see life. It's suddenly much more vibrant. It's fear goes out of the story, which is marvelous. And you just have a widening a rather blessed image of the world. It doesn't frighten you anymore. And that's the thing I've noticed about people who are really, truly initiated into that kind of work.
Now, when we were talking previously about this, I think it was the other day, we were talking about there's only a certain amount of time that you can really spend on the other side of the portal, and then you can run into some trouble. How does that work?
Well, the guide I had who had taken many people on that journey, if they were ready, and they didn't always go the whole journey because they chose to stop, you know, halfway through. It's not a lightweight thing, really. It challenges your very spirit, you know, to do it. But the thing about going through, when you're finally at the portal let's say, the portal face, where you actually enter the portal. It's like going onto a fairground ride, and you have no control. No control is there at all. And the guide said to me, forget control. Belief would be a better answer. So it's a, you've built up belief, you've built up the things you're going to need for that journey. And when you come to that entrance, there is still that moment where you can back off and go back. Now, what is it like? It's, you have no idea of time yourself. But the thing about it is you're given certain trigger points where you know it's time to come back. You always go back to the north. Your head is going back to the north. To go to the south is to go to death. The thing really with the portal journey is if you leave it too long, your body is outside the portal. You don't go in with your body. You go in with your etheric body and your consciousness, but your body is still waiting for you outside. If you don't get back in time, you can then find your body is closing down and you can have other physical, quite bad manifestations trying to get back in. That is a real key thing about doing any work with portals, is to know your timing, and it can't be long. And in fact, when portal journeys, they can seem like you've been away for endless time, and in fact you've been less than 5 minutes. That's
wow,
it's incredible.
Yeah, so there is a huge difference in time. Now, you talk about you need to go when you're inside there and you need to your time is coming up, you need to go north. How do you know where north is? You bring a compass in there? I mean,
No, you don't. But how do you know? Because you've done the work before you ever go in the portal. Everything you do builds up to the portal, to the entrance and the journey. But you've had to have done those weeks, and it's not days, it's weeks of work. So you know very well wherever you are, where your north is. The north is where the mysteries are. The north is where the everything goes to the north. It's the place to go to. It's safe and it's sound, and you go there. And you feel that in your body. You've learned where north is. Doesn't matter about east, west, you don't want to go south. That's the things that I was taught. Probably wisely, because several people didn't make it back into their bodies in time. And one person who just about got back in told me quite a lot about the portal experience, and how when she tried, she was a very, very good medium, psychic. She did get back into her body, but she'd had a stroke and they took her to AE. And she knew what had happened. Her body had closed down, but she was still there. She was fully conscious. She wanted to go home. And they said, well, no, you've got to stay here now, you're ill. They didn't know what had happened to her. But what was good about this was she was able to tell people how it was. And so it was a very, now this lady took a lot of long journeys. I'm much more fearful. I just do very, very small ones that are agreed upon. She would go to other dimensions. Mm-hmm. So she would go to other planets. So there was no question about that she had any fear or she had any doubt about her abilities, but nonetheless she left it on one occasion a bit late. That's really how it was with her, and that's why people are advised not to do it on their own, but to do it with somebody else who has done it long, you know, is an initiate and knows what to do and how to teach you.
Now, if you get into trouble on the other side of the portal and you have a guide, I would think the guide would then be able to help you, even though they're outside the portal?
That's very interesting, because what I didn't know until I actually did it was that the guide you've been working with comes with you to the portal entrance and then is gone. Mm-hmm. And your guide then is someone on the other side of life. And it's usually someone you've known, and it's quite often a surprise. So the whole thing about it is no expectations. You go on a journey and you find so much. It's a marvelous experience. It's a fairground ride in a way, but it's also things that I suppose in a way that are inside you, that some part of you recognizes these things that you see. But they're not things that are normally in our lives in the everyday. And so is it valuable? Yes, because you know there's so much more out there. It makes you have a different belief in life, and also it changes you as a person.
I would imagine this is a very dramatic journey. And when you're on the other side of the portal, time is different, as you mentioned. And what else? I mean, does it look like a different world when you're there?
Well, the furthest I've been with it, I must say that the shapes begin to start to change. And you start to, by the time, really, I mean, the portal is a journey through this life. You pass through what you've already done since birth. That's very quick. It's like a little skin. You then go into previous lives, which are longer. You think, oh, I recognize that. Oh, that's interesting. Oh, I'd love to see him again, whatever it is. And then you go into much further back stuff. And they become more vivid as you go further back and more clear. And you speed off and then you slow down and you're part of a scene, a town, an event, and then you suddenly jump out of that and you're into a place where there's nothing human. Human is no longer there. So you're into a world of color and sound and vastness, but it has a personality. It has shapes that are like signs. And I believe that those are the language of where you're passing through. I haven't gone further than that. That's as far as I've gone. But other people talk about, you know, going to, say, Venus and how that experience is. And it sounds wonderful. It really sounds like we all should go. But, it will probably take a whole lifetime here to get ready to do that journey. That's the thing.
It sounds so exciting, and yet I can see what you're talking about. It could create trepidation in one's very soul as you walk through these things. Now, it sounds also a lot like recapitulation when you're looking at different aspects of your life from the other side of the portal. Is it a way also of clearing things?
You've already done the clearing that you can do before you set foot anywhere near it. You've got rid of any kind of doubts about the journey. It's like you're ready to go to the moon. You're ready to get in the spaceship. You're going to go. You don't know what's really going to happen. Are you going to come back? I mean, there's all these questions in your head. But basically, when you start, you go on that journey. The things about your life are clear. That's one of the things the guide does. The guide has a lot of work to do, and often the one who's about to hopefully be initiated, that one is usually rebellious because a lot is taken off you. The things that are our everyday needs and beliefs, well, they're all gone. So you're kind of rather naked there, you know, with this journey, which may or may not return to the earth. But anyway, the thing about the portal is that during the journey through it, some of the things, it's usually only one or two that have really been key points in your life that you, where you couldn't make a decision, where you feel you made the wrong decision, where you made the mistake, where you didn't take that jump, whatever it is, that is addressed. And it's like you're advised, you're helped mercifully to see really what that was and how perhaps you had no choice. So in a way, it's merciful, I would say, yes.
Gosh, what a powerful experience. But again, as you've mentioned, some people don't make it back. So we need to talk about that a little more after the break. And also after the break, what I want to ask you about, and I know PK is chomping at the bit to ask you too, is
to
about
good.
That phone call from NASA. We're going to hear all about this.
Yes.
What an exciting evening this is going to be with Patrice Chaplin. She is the author of a new book called The Stone Cradle. So everybody just stay tuned, because it's a wild ride tonight on Supernatural Girlz. We will be right back. Welcome back, everyone, to Supernatural Girlz Radio. I'm your host, Patricia Baker. I'm here with my co-host, PK, and our illustrious guest, who we're so blessed to have on the air with us tonight, Patrice Chaplin. She is the author of a new book called The Stone Cradle, and we are talking about all the stuff we love tonight, right, PK?
We are so fortunate to have not only all this interesting information from her book, but now from her personally.
I know. So, Patrice, right before we took the break, we were talking about what happens when people don't make it back. Now, you did say there was a lady who stayed out longer than normal, and she came back, and her body had a stroke, but she did survive. What about the people that don't survive? What happens? They stay out too long?
No, they go into spirit in the normal way that we would when we pass on. So they wouldn't not be anywhere, but they would go to the spirit world. But their body remain here as normal as normally happens. But they would, we could say they died prematurely because of what did.
So there wouldn't even necessarily be a cause of death. They would just have an empty vessel sitting here on this side of the portal.
It would be a body in movement, in closing down. It wouldn't be a body that was, it wouldn't be empty. It would be, let's not say suffering, but it would certainly be closing down. That would be the thing.
I see.
And
okay, fascinating.
The woman who did have that happen, she was able, because she was very, very mediumistic, trained in working and, with vast spaces from here. She could really go a long way. And amazingly focused, wonderful work she did, and very wonderful healer. But the thing was that she didn't have fear. She would just go. She would go into other dimensions. No fear at all. But she forgot time. He had to come back. But she remembered, her body. I said, they said to her, your body had a stroke. And she understood what had happened and said, no, I'm going to leave the A&E, or whatever she muttered, or however she managed to do it. But they wouldn't let her. They kept her in hospital. And then eventually, when she came out, she was able to talk about it, but it was a lesson to all of us.
Yes.
We've got to go by the rules. That's it.
Right. Exactly. Now, I mentioned also right before the break that you had a very interesting phone call. And this call came from someone at NASA. Can you tell us all about what happened?
Well, I did have a phone when the book came out. That was City of Secrets that came out, and it did mention portals, because that seemed to be what the whole secret of Gerona and that area was about, was portals, and that people didn't know about them, and they shouldn't know about them, because they weren't, it wasn't advisable to start doing journeys along those pathways. And so nobody actually understood, really, that there was more beyond the portal. The publisher, who did City of Secrets in America, and another one did it over here, but the American one got the call from NASA and from a really nice person, you know, said would I talk and I about what had happened, and I said yes, and then he came on to me and asked if I would talk to someone. It was just a question I had to answer about what I'd written, and I said yeah, and so they put me through to this man who asked about if I'd ever come across an artificial portal. Well, I hadn't, because I'd come across two or three maximum actual portals, because I'd been shown where they were. I didn't find them all by myself. And I'd been told about other portals, but no, artificial, never heard of those. And so he said, well, there was an aviator in the 40s and the 50s, you know, who was very keen on portals. And after the Second World War, he had engaged some scientists from Germany to come and work on creating portals. And I didn't think who it could be. I just thought, I don't know who, I don't know what these are. And the man told me they were portals, but without an immunity, without any kind of protection, because they were made swiftly, and they hadn't had the proper time to be a portal, if you like. They were kind of like, you know, rather cheap ones that let in everything, and also let out other things into space as well. So there had been things received and things gone out from this planet, but the thing that they wanted to do was to destroy all artificial portals. I didn't ask who it was, but later I found out who it was who'd made these portals, and I thought how strange, seeing that he, Howard Hughes, had such an kind of ill childhood. You know, he'd been ill a lot. And right. I would have thought, you know, some kind of immunity would be part of his life. I think he was kept, you know, isolated, you know, quite a while when he was sick. And yet the portals didn't have that, which was so essential for their survival. So things anyway got in. So the man asked me if I knew, would know what one looked like. I didn't, I wouldn't. But if I found one, would I let them know? And I just took this as one of many calls that I got around the time of that book. That the fact is, I've completely forgot anything about artificial portals until Howard Hughes was mentioned as having been in Gerona with Otto Rahn in 1933. And that's when I found out that he was the man that the NASA people were interested, you know, obviously in what he'd done and how he'd worked at creating portals. And it was mainly in the States, so that's where they are.
Well, there was, again, I remember discussing this with you. It was very interesting about how Howard Hughes and Jack Parsons, who was very much involved in creating this rocket fuel that eventually killed him, but that also is suspect, whether it was murder or an accident. But Jack Parsons, Howard Hughes, CIA agents, and people from Project Paperclip were all involved in trying to blow holes in our atmosphere to create portals over here. And I remember you saying that Howard Hughes, in his later years, was thought to have dementia. That he had these long fingernails and long hair, and he was just totally out of it. But you had another explanation
for this.
Yes. Please share that. That was fascinating.
I met a pilot who was Norwegian, and he'd been chosen to fly the heavy jets in America when he was 17. And Howard Hughes certainly was aware of him and wanted him to work for him, which he didn't. He stayed working for the U.S. Aviation. But he did get to know Howard Hughes, and he went to see him in this huge bunker that he had, which was filled with, as he said, soothsayers and clairvoyants and scientists and Nazi scientists and, right, and CIA, right, and everything. And then Howard would come down wearing either his pajama tops or bottoms, and the hair was all hanging down. And he said, well, we got him into a suit and put a tie on him or whatever. But he said he was never, ever crazy. That was not so. His nerves were shot from going through all these little holes, little gateways. He called them pathways or gateways. And he said by doing all that, his nerves were gone, so that, you know, a cockroach looked like a dinosaur to him. And yet, on other days, he had all this power where he could just fly to the sun. Literally, that's what he felt he could do. He had immense desire to go further and faster than anyone else. But he said he was never mad.
Yeah, well, you know, given this explanation, it puts a whole different spin on it. It makes tremendous sense. So it's just a great, great story about Howard Hughes and other portals. And it makes me wonder, Patrice, is this a technology that the CIA was trying to create for their own use? And then, of course, there is the possibility of abuse with something like that.
Well, I think that story about the Philadelphia experiment, I think, mm-hmm, that a boat disappeared, didn't it, for 40 years?
Yes, right.
Mm-hmm. But it obviously went in and out of time. I think that's what happens in portals. You go in and out of time. Mm-hmm. And I think it went wrong. And when I asked the Norwegian aviator, I said, you know, what happened with that? And he just laughed and he said, well, you don't talk about that. It was just a little mishap.
Well, it's, oh, God. Boy.
What a mishap.
A mishap. A little one. Can you imagine what a big one would be? Okay.
Yeah, I know. So that was his explanation for that. He just said, well, it's bound to happen because they were changing time, going from one layer to another, going from one dimension to another. So you're not in the four we know. You're in probably eight. I mean, Salvador Dali, without jumping over there too fast, but I mean, he would go into the dimensions where you were invisible, where we become invisible. So, and that's not too many dimensions away. And as the Kabbalists were already doing it in Gerona, in the, you know, the Middle Ages, it's possible, you know, that we can reach those kind of levels. But the question is, are we meant to? That's
yes,
the thing.
That's what I was curious about. How many portals do you think are out there?
Well, my guide, who was wonderful, she was a Habsburg, actually. She's passed on now. She loved portals. And she said that there were some which were so beautiful and magnificent that we couldn't even approach them because their electric energy, their dynamic was so powerful, we'd just be crushed. So we wouldn't even get near it. So they would be surrounded with a kind of weak, bad energy. So we wouldn't go very far into it because we'd feel unwell and would back off. So we never got to the beautiful, rich, marvelous portals filled with history and all kinds of stuff. We didn't go there. We go to much smaller ones where we would feel well. So they didn't have such a big output. And so it sounded, when she was talking, it sounded like snakes and ladders, you know, that game. It felt a bit like that, were kind of big ones, little ones, you know, then you missed a few and then you went somewhere else. But in the time going back, you know, for sort of like 1,000 years and even less, in mid-Europe and especially Romania and places like that, people went to the portals, like we go to health farms to feel well.
Oh.
because the energy was so good. So, I mean, I've been in joyous portals. Two of those, and one which was quite bad, quite shallow and quite bad. And a lot of people around that area were very involved in like drugs and, you know, chemical substances. It was a kind of an easy but kind of shallow place. That wasn't such a good portal. That was in Paris. And there was one in Gramercy Park. That was quite famous.
So they are around. Yes. Now, here's a question for you, Patrice, from Daria. And she's saying, hi, I am loving this show. Is there a TV show or movie that you believe best portrays what these experiences are like?
Yes. The book I wrote called Siesta was made into a movie in the 1980s, and it had Ellen Barkin in it and Grace Jones. It had, you know, a lot of people in it, but and Miles Davis did the music. But the important thing about it was about going through a portal.
Excellent.
I mean, I just say that because I wrote it. So it was
writing. And you would know better than anybody else anyway.
Well, no, that was, to me, that's a portal to me.
Yes.
That's
it. Yes.
It's in paperback. It's in Kindle. It's there.
So we're going to have to all watch the movie now that we've read the book. We got to go watch the movie. And so there you go, Daria. Yeah. There's the great answer to your question. Now you can go watch the movie, Siesta. And lots of questions about portals coming into the chat room tonight. Some of them you've already answered. Like Trisha, for example, wanted to know, does the body physically travel through or is it just the mind? And you've already answered that, right? You said it was the etheric body that goes through, not the physical body.
Yeah. And the focusing, you know, and the consciousness goes through. But the body itself, the physical body, you don't walk through, no.
Now, it's lots of questions coming in again. Here's a bunch from Liz. She wants to know, what does it feel like to be in the portal?
Exciting. Completely renewing. It's an experience unlike any other that I've had, or that other people I know have experienced them have had. So it's new. It's more vivid as you go along. It's kind of like a pilgrimage or something. It's on a really high level of ourselves. It's not a kind of repetitive trip in any way. It's inspiring in some ways. I think the main thing is it's what you feel when you come back. And I think that coming back, you can feel, in my case, certainly freedom and tremendous sense of being alive and looking at things, of seeing them. And so I don't know a drug that you could take which would make you feel so, I guess, exalted and free. I think it would be one of the best experiences that I've ever done would be the portal journeys. Yes,
excellent. And then, now there was a great medicine man here in the United States called Geronimo. And he was known for using portals to go from one place to another, miles and miles away, but he would be able to do it in a matter of minutes. Somebody was just asking, also Liz again was asking, can we use portals for travel, like a wormhole?
Oh, yeah, definitely. Yes, we can. And they are used sometimes. They can be used. And also for healing, I've known for example, I've done healing for somebody who is quite ill, 100 miles away, I'd say it's midnight, hear the bells going, and I'm wearing a yellow dress with a certain design on, for example, and the next day I'll make a phone call and ask if the person is better, and the person is better, and describe someone coming wearing a yellow dress and being by the bed. It doesn't
say. Oh, it was you.
Yes,
fabulous.
The person didn't recognize me as me. So if someone there wearing yellow, and this man felt very well, he felt very good and very reassured. I was pleased about that because it was really, you know, a really kind of beautiful thing to do. But more, it showed me that you're in one place and there you are at the same time in another place. So you're many, many miles away from the person and indeed from what you're doing. So there is something where it's split.
Yes. Yes. So it can be used that way. Now, we've got to start talking about the Stone Cradle. This is a great book, and it's an adventure story. And again, wherever you go, Patrice, intrigue follows. You've got all kinds of interesting characters in this book, and certainly the path was twists and turns along the way. We can't recommend this book highly enough for everybody interested in this topic. But for everybody listening, we are dying to hear about this. What was it that set you off on the path to find the Stone Cradle?
Oh, well, that came from the other two books, from City of Secrets and from The Portal, although they're independent of the Stone Cradle. But this is the result of what went on before. The Stone Cradle was the thing. It was a thing. It's not a thing. I mean, the object of the society in Gerona, which was ancient. It's been going on since time, you know, time and before time. In a way, this whole practice of keeping this revered object secret. And kept away. It was a privileged object, and it still is. I mean, it's very, very old. Obviously, it's millions of years old. Stone. It is made of stone. It's a meteorite, and it was said that when it came through when it busts its way through the meteor belt, it was as big as a double decker bus, because people have looked at it, measured it. And its arrival here, it was a completely smooth and beautiful blue stone in the shape of, it wasn't in the shape then of a cradle. It didn't have that dip. That came from all the people who have lain on it for ritual reasons and healing. That's what's made that curve in the stone. But it does rock. It is, and it is called the cradle. So there's no. It's always been called la cuna piedra, the stone cradle. It's the thing. It goes sort of beyond the portal, but it's attached to the portal. It's not so much what the stone was and did. It's who lay on it. That's the thing, and that was always kept a secret because it was. I suppose in opposition, really, to belief of the church, you know, so that it makes sense that everyone kept it quiet. But people went to seek the cradle, and also because the person that came through and lay in that cradle and was rocked in that cradle actually lifted up, you know, humanity, their evolvement was lifted by the teaching. This man who came there, this being rather that came there, was a teacher. And so mankind benefited from what he had to give. And he was resting through and was laying on that cradle.
Oh my gosh. Well, now Patrice, we're going to have to take just another short break. And when we come back, we want to hear the rest of what happens when you touch the cradle or lay on the cradle. But we also want to hear who did, who this was meant for. And we got to find that out. So, everybody, we are taking a very short commercial break. We're speaking with Patrice Chaplin, the author of The Stone Cradle. And you are listening to Supernatural Girlz Radio. We'll be right back. Welcome back, everyone, to Supernatural Girlz Radio. I'm your host, Patricia Baker. I'm here with my co-host, PK, and our amazing guest, who we love so much, Patrice Chaplin. She's so kind to stay up so late because she's there in the UK talking to us tonight. And we have so much to talk about. So, Patrice, we're talking about the stone cradle, a mystical object. But it really exists. This is a real stone. This is not something made up. This is real.
Absolutely real. But there are other stones as well on the planet which are magical as well. And they're usually meteorites, and they have a purpose, as does the stone cradle. And they're very real, and people do go to them because they have a magnetic sense to them, which either heals or transforms in some way the person who needs to go there. And it's like some of the, you know, the revered stone, you know, at Mecca, that's another one. It's supposed to be a meteorite, and another one in France in a place called Le Puy, where it's the same kind of stone as the one, the cradle stone in Gerona. But Gerona, well, it's not in Gerona, it's outside in the wild country. It's in where there are no people. That's where the stone is. But the thing about that stone, it has an extra dimension to it. But the thing with the portals, if I hadn't have done the work on the portals, which didn't give the secret, they gave a lot of stuff and knowledge and experience, but not the secret. The secret was always hidden behind everything else. And it was only, I think, by being chosen to do the work eventually that I got to know that what was the real story was always the stone cradle. And that was, for years, people knew about it. And, you know, say 300 or 400 years ago, it was open and used as, it was a stone where people who had the plague or whatever they had, they went there to be cured. Or they went there to have their children, or indeed sometimes to die. So it was known, it was a very useful stone.
How large is this stone?
Well, if you think about, you couldn't, I mean, a tall guy would have to kind of bend his knees up or have him hanging over it. I mean, 6'3" or something, that would, you know, it would fit the average person lying straight. So we're talking about, and it rocks. So it's about, you know, 5'10" or something. I mean, that's in feet. That's not what you deal with, is it? So if you think very tall, they have to adjust to it. Normal size, medium, bit taller, fine, lie flat on it. And it does rock. So you're completely, the thing about a cradle is you're totally alone in a cradle. You've got no one else there.
And it rocks, like a cradle would rock. Oh, gosh.
Yeah, and it's stone. And stone has holes in it, in the side, because it had nutrients that fed people that lay there. It wasn't just, it had other qualities to it. They were mineral nutrients and things called condules, which I'm not scientific. I don't know what those are exactly, but they're very old. They come from a long time ago, thousands of years ago. And now, the stone, I know you're going to ask me about according to legend, the people in Spain call the one that came there from space, from another place, the child of light. But it became more apparent that it was Lucifer.
Aha!
And Lucifer, definitely, it was 5,000 years plus, came to the planet and was, according to the legend, was looked after. He didn't come through, with a human mother. He was looked after by an Asian female or goddess. And the thing about it is, which is strange, is that in a small church in the mountains nearby, in north of Gerona, in the Pyrenees, there's a small chapel where there is an effigy of an Oriental woman, and with swords in her chest. And why she's Oriental, no one could say. And the legend has it that this goddess was there, or the female was there, to look after Lucifer, who came as a teacher to lift mankind up onto a higher level. And it's said that Lucifer did, where did he go wrong and where did he go right? Well, he gave man, he showed man freedom of choice. Mm-hmm. That seems to be where the problem started. And then man was, eating that apple, that cost a lot to everybody, but would it have happened anyway? Would man have changed it? Who knows? But that's really where the light bearer, the Venus is the cradle's protector. So Venus and the cradle are linked, and Lucifer came and was a very strong morning star, the light bearer connection to Venus, and there came he to the cradle and was present at the building of the first pyramid. And this is all noted in a lot of the Kabbalistic material of the Middle Ages, when they wrote down a lot of the stuff, which then, or mainly oral tradition, because people didn't write things down. And the ones who had the most knowledge of the Child of Light were the Celts, who came before Gerona was established. They came probably 3,000 years, 3,000 BC. So they were there in small settlements near Gerona because it was a very rich and fruitful place. It was a very, very lush place for people to live. So they were there, and they had the oral traditions of the Child of Light, who then traversed the earth and was at, Egypt. There's a connection with Egypt there. And today the society that holds the information, they have a duty to keep going the light, which this Child of Light brought, because it is finite. It's not there automatically forever. It's wearing out. So their job is to do rituals, and they do prayers, they do initiations to keep the light going there and to keep the knowledge there. So there's a lot of stuff on another dimension there. So if you work at the psychic side of the breathing there, and all the fasting, the initiates work, you can go onto those other levels. I don't think automatically you could go there and even reach level one. I wouldn't think so. But with some work, you can do it.
it's a lot of work of purification, I would imagine. And also, now for you, Patrice, have you, you've touched this stone cradle. You've been there. That's amazing.
But I didn't know when I first went there. I was 15, and I went there with the man that I've written about in these books, who was the actual custodian later on of the society. He's the one who has all the secrets. It's not me. I've only had to kind of follow them around and experience them to some degree. He's the one who has them. And I went into the cradle. It was looked after by a priest who took care of it. And people would visit the cradle, not because they were sick then, but because they wanted to see it and to have the experience of doing some of the rituals and the practices associated with it, because they made them feel good. I mean, they felt very, very well when they did this.
Now, do you take people on these journeys where they can experience the stone cradle?
No, I can't do that.
You can't.
I have gone with a few people there, with the object of bringing the material out into use, you know, for everybody. I mean, that's the idea. The material, bringing it out, is, you know, the practices, the rituals, and going into sort of trance state. All of this is beneficial and good, and that certainly is something I can do. But the other stuff, decisions about what happens to the cradle, is not for me to even go into. I think really basically I'm a writer, so I write about it rather than be a practitioner. Does that make sense?
Yes, certainly does. Yes, your writing is amazing. And again, everybody should go out and buy your new book, The Stone Cradle. It is tremendous. Again, it's an adventure story of a real journey, a trek that you've been on about this thing. Now, here's an interesting comment question from Carol in our chat room. She says, is the cradle a manifestation of a metaphor that we are infantile and immature in our philosophy as a species?
Ooh. Oh, as a species, maybe, yes. As a metaphor for now, yeah, individually, no. But it is that the cradle is said to be the object that those spirits coming from the Great Bear constellation, which is the one that influences that area in Gerona, the Great Bear, that those spirits have to pass through the cradle to be born, just as spirits coming out of death have to pass through it to go into the spirit world. So it is considered a link between the two. The other thing about it is that I think the fear about something which is valuable, as this object is, that some people always want to take it and have it for themselves. That's
yes, that's right. That's a concern.
Yeah, and they're not going to leave it there. So there's a, you know, there's a lot of tension around it, which of course makes secrets more heightened, and people are more curious, because if the thing was just laid open on the ground, we'd probably never notice it. But because there's a lot written about it, and there's lots of text, and there's lots of these people who, look, I think basically there was another group of people long before Neanderthal man that was around that time in that area. I feel they were probably superior spirits. They were more evolved and they were different to us. But there's a memory and essence. There's something still left of those people there. And that's been kind of confirmed time and again about that. I don't know if they were pre-Atlantis. I don't know. I mean, I've no idea. But they have an energy which, when you go to the place, you get the sense that there has been something sweet and sort of beyond our usual sort of limits here, that is quite beautiful, quite wonderful. And that's the essence also of the cradle. It is a beneficial object. And I don't think it certainly was, apparently it was a nutrient object for the child of light. That child was fed by the stone, looked after by the stone, didn't need other things. But there's a guild, you see, if you look at the things that are existing there today, they're all in celebration of the light and Lucifer, they're Luciferic. So there's like a guild called the Guild of Luz, L-U-Z, and that's been going for many hundreds of years, as far as I know. And it's it's in reference to the Child of Light. And there are towers, and there are certain private churches, and there's stones, ritual stones, in gratitude or celebration of the Child of Light, memory. So it's sort of claimed there, not as a bad object. Whether you see, Lucifer, in effect, deflected light. And so that's considered not good, you see. Where did he get the light? And what's behind the light? That's the point. So it's a bit of a moot question whether it was Lucifer or whether it was the Child of Light. That's the thing. But whatever it was, that being was present according to the effects of that time still existent and legend. So it was a good being there. It wasn't something that came and made everything on the earth worse. So let's have a then. We could do with it again.
Exactly. And this is so fascinating. Now, people want to know, is there a photograph of this stone cradle somewhere?
They have images, photographs. They have many, many tech things about that. Yes, they do. It's a blue stone. It's Salvador Dali, the painter, Catalan painter out there, who knew that stone quite well. He's fascinated by it. He said it was not on four dimensions, it was on 23. It could pass through 23 dimensions.
Wow.
It has a connection as well, possibly with Nicholas Rurik through Jean Cocteau, who's another. Here I go name dropping all these names, which may not mean a lot, but they are the ones that actually carried the secret for a long time.
Gosh.
And they go back to the 1914. That's a big date for that.
Now,
it has a point in its being there, and it has an influence for good. That's the thing. And it has a celebration of light, and the light around the area is amazing. That's the other thing. It is absolutely unearthly. You know, it's almost like you would say heavenly or something.
It makes me want to go there right now.
Or Borealis.
Here's a question for you, Patrice, that one of the people in the chat room has asked twice, so I don't dare ignore him again. This is from Neutron. It's politely re-asking. We're going to go back to Rennes-le-Château for a second. He wants to know, can you tell us something or tell us of some research about Father Saunier using the area to bury or lock up negative archons there? Have you ever heard that?
No, that I haven't. I mean, I've heard about Saunier going to Gerona on visits and replicating the tower. So there were two towers, so that the energy was existent between the two, and when activated, made a portal peak on Mount Canigou, right on the peak of the Mount Canigou. That I know of. I think he was a very clever man. He had a lot to do. He left a trace. He left a message for those yet to come, initiates yet to come. He left it in symbolism, So people who would know that would go there and be able to read it. I can't, but they would. And I think that's what Sonia did. He did a lot of work there. But there was a dark side. There was a kind of, he used reflections as well. A lot of mirrors, a lot of reflections. And they tied up. Rennes-le-Château is part of the portal journey. It's part of the journey under the constellation, the Great Bear. So it's indirect, it's in a reflecting distance of Gerona and of what we've been talking about, the cradle. It's not far away from there.
Gosh, incredible.
It's all in the same area. It's interesting because all, you know, it's only in a small area. If one goes from Gerona and goes over to Rennes-le-Château, it's what, 3 hours? That's all. And the peak in the middle is Canigou, which is the sacred mountain of the Catalans. And there we have the portal. The main portal is there, right on the peak. And the cradle is nearby. So it's all together in one place. And the energy there is different, and how you feel there is different to how you feel in other places. If you go from there, where everything is on a high energy level, and you can feel all kinds of feelings depending on how it affects you, but you go to somewhere like London, it feels quite neutral, and you're back to neutrality again, which may suit you better. You know, it doesn't suit everyone to be on that kind of energy level.
Yes, it's so different. Now, here's another quick question for you, Patrice. Someone would like to know, is dreaming kind of a portal, seeing it allows you to see into another place in time?
No, because no, it isn't. It's a different state, because dreaming is you're taking on a journey of, you know, of your subconscious mind and other things taking you on this, which is you partly remember, you partly are conscious of, you partly you're mainly a passenger, you see. With doing the portal journeys, you've got to be focused, you've got to start out focused. I know there's no control, and it's all about better have belief than control, or faith, that were her words, the guide. But you have to definitely, before you ever attempt, you know, to even go through on that journey, you've got to have worked on focus. So all these probably dreams reflect it. I think dreams have reflections that they have similarities with portals, put it that way. The interior of a portal and the quality of a dream could match each other. Yes, they could.
Now, but do you, I know you said you don't take people to see the stone cradle necessarily, but do you take people on journeys from Rennes-le-Château to Gerona, Spain?
Oh, I used to a lot. Yes, I did. And it was very interesting in its own way, how people changed on the journeys. And what came, you know, from their changes and their reactions to it, it was yet more added to the story, more added to the learning. There's some amazing times, and amazing. You can do incredible in those energy areas. You can do incredible meditations and practices, and you can, I think, almost you could levitate. You know, I'm not saying that people do. Yeah, you know, if you're going to fly or levitate, those are stuff to do. Yeah.
It would happen there if it was going to happen anywhere. Goodness, it's such an exciting, exciting journey that you're still on, Patrice. I wonder what's next for you.
Oh, because I'm writing, I am writing about Lucifer.
Ooh.
Oh.
Yeah.
And I'm excited about that.
Well, Lucifer being, you know, I mean, he's condemned to eternity. So he's going to be alive for, like, ever. And you know, where is he? Well, he could be right here in the modern day, couldn't he, with us?
Oh, I cannot
Sometimes
wait.
Sometimes I think he hears here.
Yes.
Gosh. And well, when should we look forward to that, Patrice?
Well, that's quite soon. It's illustrated. It's got marvelous illustrations by a really good artist here. So that, you know, it's all there.
Oh, gosh. Well, Patrice, we've got to, unfortunately, have come to the end of our time with you. We could talk to you all night, but I'm sure you'd like to also say goodnight. It's been a late night for you over there in the UK. And thank you. Thank you so much. And everybody, go out and buy this great book, The Stone Cradle by Patrice Chaplin. Buy your other books, The Portal, and all the other books that are listed on Amazon. They're terrific. And thank you for joining us tonight. We will be back next week with another terrific show. We have a psychic coming on. She's going to be doing free readings for people. Don't miss that. Until then, we'll see you on the Blue Highway. Good night, everyone.
Good night.
Night.